Hello, Steve. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you. Happy to be here.
Thank you so much. You are kind of a legend and an inspiration in the deep tech community. And you've been the founder of Future Ventures and DFJ. And you created more than $1 trillion of value by investing in deep tech startups like SpaceX, Tesla, Planet, D-Wave, Boring, Upside Foods. This is really impressive, and I guess every one of us aspire to invest like you in deep tech. Let me start by asking you the first question, which is, why did you invest in Tesla at such an early stage?
Oh, that's a great question. And part of the context is this was back in 2006, when all prior automotive startups had failed, not just, you know, made small returns, but absolutely went bankrupt, completely destroyed as business ideas. And so the question, there's always a little bit of context, like why in the world would a venture firm ever invest in the automotive sector? And one of the simple frameworks that I've used throughout my deep tech investing has been to look for the usual things, you know, great entrepreneurs, big markets, disruptive change, the usual stuff. But to add an additional filter, which is to try to find unique ideas that are unlike anything I've seen before, yet adjacent to places I've been before, meaning places I've invested before. So in this specific case, Tesla was the only electric car company seeking funding at the time. There were two others that are less well known, to be precise, but they weren't cars in the sense that you and I would drive. They had no roof, they had no door, or they were kit cars. This companies that have since faded from view. And Tesla was really radically different. So checkbox, unlike anything we've seen before. So part of that could be naivete, right? Like, you know, there's a lot of things we haven't seen before. But it needs to be something that we're familiar with. And so the bridge to where we've been before is that the battery technology, the transition to clean, sustainable energy futures was very dear and close to our hearts. We had been investing for the prior almost decade in a variety of what would be called energy and clean tech companies. So we had invested in many battery companies, many solar companies, companies like SolarCity and others. That gave us a perspective that the time was ripe, that now you could actually put together a vehicle that you couldn't have done 10 years ago and had the range and the performance that was interesting for consumers. So there was another checkbox item embedded in there. It's like, now is the time this car company could start, and they couldn't have started 10 years ago or 20 years ago or at any time in history. And that's also a good sign, if you will. And then lastly, there is, of course, the sheer size and disruption it would present to the automotive industry. So we've seen this pattern with SpaceX and aerospace and Tesla and automotive, and we can talk about others, where you have an industry that's gone 50, sometimes 100 years without any major new entrant. No entrepreneur has made a dent in the industry. So that's actually a positive in a way, in that the big companies have no idea how to compete with a new entrant. They're just not used to it. They're only used to doing business as usual, selling their cars through the same dealer channels, manufacturing internal combustion engines. Every part of their business model was ripe for disruption, as we've now seen. And the company saw that. They painted a picture for us of exactly what has happened. The master plan of Tesla has played out to this day, exactly the way they published it to the world from day one, which is kind of astounding, right? By the way, without relying on patents, without relying on some major fundamental technology breakthrough at a component level, they were integrating off-the-shelf batteries, off-the-shelf electronics, putting it into a package like never before, and most importantly, layering a software and simulation sort of harness on it such that the product improved more quickly than any other product before.
No, it makes a lot of sense. When you say it, by the way, it looks like very easy. And I remember 2006, 2007, because I'm working in the automotive industry, it was not so obvious to believe in Tesla. So congratulations on this one.
Oh yeah, almost everyone who knew something thought it was ridiculous. So this is why all the major car companies dismissed Tesla. There's just no way that's going to work. We've seen people try and fail before.
I remember that very vividly. So I'm super impressed. Another question I have is, you once mentioned that you invest in what is inevitable. And there is this question that you also said or asked, is what are the inevitable endpoints that no one will debate? How do you put this question into action?
Well, it's an interesting way of asking it. How I put it to action is when I'm sitting in a pitch meeting, I always ask myself, okay, what was the world going to look like 500 years from now? And I pick 500 years because it's so far out that you can't get hung up on where we are today. So here's a simple example. Will we burn petroleum in car engines, these incredibly inefficient, you know, internal combustion engines that waste 80% of the oil they burn as waste heat. And oh, by the way, we have a finite amount on planet Earth. Like 500 years from now, there's no question. We won't burn oil. Like it just can't be. You can get into big debates what happens over the next 5 years, but 500 years, you know, that's the inevitable future. So you chain back from that future to the present day in your mind, be like, well, how in the world do we get to that future? What would be the most logical starting point? How do we bridge, if you will, the branching points of where we are to the inevitable points where we're going to be? And what would be the investment we think that can bridge the gap? And so in the case of Tesla, we thought starting on a high-end vehicle and then migrating to a more affordable vehicle would be the path that makes the most sense. With SpaceX, the reusability of the rockets. Or I'll give another example. If you think out 500 years, is it really possible that we're going to raise cows, slaughter them for meat, and take that portion of the animal as our food that we consume? Right now, about 30 to 40% of all usable land on Earth is dedicated to animal meat production. It's incredibly inefficient. We know already we can do 10 times better on energy, on land, on water, on the lack of, you know, avian flu or what, mad cow disease or swine fever, all these problems with meat manufacturing. 500 years from now, obviously we won't be doing that. We obviously won't do it on Mars, you know, if we're thinking about future human settlements on other planets. What is the future of meat manufacturing? And phrasing it that way, we'll still eat meat, but how will we make it? And so companies that are, you know, leading in cellular agriculture to me seem like the inevitable future. We're just, our grandchildren will look back and marvel at what we did to animals, right? And we don't think about it, we don't talk about it, we don't visit slaughterhouses. In fact, we're often not allowed to because it's so horrific, right? And I'm a meat eater, by the way. I'm not saying this out of some, you know, a religious passion that I have. I know I will in the future look back at my present sense self and say, wow, that was really kind of immoral what we did to, you know, animals that are smarter than our pets. But, you know, that's one of these inevitabilities. And it gives me great passion. By the way, entrepreneurs love it too. Like when you share their passion for the inevitable future, they get it. They're, you know, that passion drives the employees that they hire, the partners that they get, the first customers. The business is so much easier if you're on a mission to change the world for the better in a way that everyone agrees is the right side of history.
But when do you know that the timing is right? Because I totally love the idea of 500 years, you know, outside. But as we've seen in the past, in some cases, you know, like clean tech, for example, there was lots of investment and, you know, many companies failed.
It's a really good point. It's probably my biggest failing. I was probably 15 years too early in quantum computing. I was probably misguided in some ways in the way I thought about nanotech as a change. It's sort of a technology change. It's not a business change. I knew that, but I think it was just too easily confused. And it took a long time for materials changes and material science to ripple through and change products that people care about. So I've sometimes been too early. That is a failing, but it's an acquired skill. I think the more you do it, you get a sense for what's a science project versus what's a business ready for shipment to consumers. And you can think of Tesla as a great example. They are able to cobble together a vehicle you could drive around and actually experience the acceleration. And that makes all the difference versus hypothetically saying, oh, give me a lot of money in one day, 10 years from now, I will pop an amazing car people want to buy, right? Very different proposition. So there's something about, as I've come to learn, building revenue with real customers over time as you seek that enormous change in the market, not trying to do it all in once, right? Don't do it in one big step function, do it in an iterative fashion. The way SpaceX did Falcon 1 to Falcon 9, the way Tesla did the Roadster to the sedan, that's essential. And that's really what has allowed me to avoid problems in those kinds of companies.
Oh, thank you so much. And again, seems I love the acquired skill because I think it requires a lot of, you know, being smart, seeing a lot of things. Not an easy one.
Oh, no, I made so many mistakes. I mean, by the way, we're talking about successes. Keep in mind, most of what I've invested in has gone bankrupt. Right. So most, slightly more than 50%, complete abject failure. In the back of your mind, but you have to keep going. You can't let that, you know, shatter your faith. Because if you're, you know, the one company that makes 10,000 times your money can cover up for a lot of losses. It's all about the power law of winners.
Exactly. Right? And you learn a lot, I guess, in the process. I guess there is one question, you know, as we are speaking about climate change and many things, and COP26 has just ended. For me, I have a question, which is, you know, should we invest in deep tech and why should we invest in deep tech? You know, why is it so important? What's your view on that?
No, that's a great question. I think, and you mentioned climate in the opening, you can ask yourself the question, do you really have faith that political leaders are globally going to unite and save the world? Do you have faith that Shell, Exxon, and the companies that are killing the environment with CO2 emissions are going to change their ways within time? right? And that we can suddenly imagine there's an epiphany of leadership, a resolve that makes a difference. No. In fact, there is a rule of business more strong than any I know. In fact, I know of no counterexamples, and that is that every disruptive change in a business is led by a new entrant. It is never led by companies that are in the industry. So if you look at companies that are killing the environment, oil and gas, cement, you name it, they will not disrupt their business. It will never happen. Just like the automotive industry would never go electric ever on without a new entrant forcing it, right? Rockets would not be reusable ever unless a new entrant showed that it could be done. Same is true in every industry, right? The only big company innovation that occurs is when they go into a new industry, like when Apple enters a new business, when Hewlett-Packard entered the printer business that they weren't in before. Then they can do something radical and new, but not in their core business that they're currently making money at. So, like, don't pin any hope. There is zero possibility that climate change will be saved, right? That we will have major change in core businesses as they exist today. That is impossible. There is zero chance of that. Politics, I don't understand. You know, to me, like, I see there's almost no chance they're going to change their tune either because they're short-termist, right? They have these four-year election cycles in the U.S., different timeframes elsewhere. Nobody's thinking out 50 years. They don't, you know, they're going to be long gone. They're just not going to make change happen. So it's going to be a new entrance. It always has. It always will. So future of the earth depends on it. Increasingly, I believe every industry is becoming an information business. And in so doing, it creates opportunities for new entrants to turn them into, like you see with the car, an automotive piece of software that is an autonomous driving suite. The reason you'll buy a Tesla 5 years from now is because it'll have the best autonomous software, not because the battery is slightly better or the motor is better or that it looks cooler. It's entirely gonna be software. That's why you'll buy a car. Same is true for the rockets. The same is true increasingly for every product. We think food and construction are two major industries, trillion-dollar industries that are next for disruption. But this is why it's so important, right? It used to be the venture capitalists in the 90s just invested in software and computers and what they call biotech. Now it's every industry, right? Construction, food, things that we wouldn't have imagined just 20 years ago that we'd be investing in, and we are. And it's because you can see it with SpaceX and you can see it with Tesla. Imagine like their market share over the next 5 years. In SpaceX, it's roughly 80% of all satellites launched, of all tonnage lifted to orbit, 80%, right? That is what's going to happen to every industry. And so that's why we invest in it. That's why we think meaningful change, the kind of change that history books is written about, always comes from new entrants. It never comes from an incumbent saying, aha, radical restructuring. Like, so never expect Google to change search. Apple will never change laptops or desktops. They haven't done anything innovative for decades in laptops or desktops. It's always something new, right? And it's always, of course, the new entrants. So that's why I think it's so essential. I think it's critical to humanity's survival in a way that it wasn't before.
I'm totally with you there, and it reminds me, I work a lot in the car industry, and when the iPod went out, I remember I said to one of the car product manager, if I cannot connect my iPod on the car, I will change my brand of the car. And the guy told me that shows you how much you don't understand the car business.
And, that's right. And it was so coupled to a physical thing that had 7-year design cycles. And when you move to software and services, the way, you know, our iPhone or our Android phone is always looks the same. It's just a screen. All the upgrades are in the software and services layer. Exactly. It can run circles around a company that's expecting a physical upgrade to introduce new products and services.
Thank you so much. To conclude this interview, I would like to project you in, let's say, 2042, 20 years from now. In 20 years from now, who do you think will be the most important person on Earth, or what would be the most important company that will be remembered in history books?
That's a great question. I love this question. So I'm going to focus on a company because I'll just focus on the company part of the answer. What is the most important company in the year 2042? And I actually want everyone who's listening today to try to answer that quickly in your mind. Go with your gut instinct. What do you think the most important company is on Earth? And I have no idea how many people are listening to this right now. I'm going to guess a lot. And I will bet $100,000 versus all of you that no one gets it right. And you can call me on this bet. Normally people make bets and then they never circle back. Email yourself that bet. And if you want, CC me, steve@future.ventures. So we'll have a timestamp, a company that exists today that you think will be the most important company in 2042. And here's the most amazing thing. If anyone's right, I'll give you $100,000 in 2042. And why would I make such a crazy bet? Because I have no idea how many of you are out there, nor do I know what you might be saying, right? What I'm essentially betting is that none of you is right because that company doesn't yet exist. It doesn't yet even have a name. And looking forward 20 years, that might seem crazy. Like, how could I be so willing to bet on the new entrant? But that is exactly what I've seen time and time again. And it looks a little clearer when you look in retrospect. 20 years ago, no Tesla. 20 years ago, no SpaceX. 20 years ago, no Facebook. The companies that are reworking the fabric of society, that are redefining the world we live in the most meaningful ways, did not exist 20 years ago. They were not even a dream in the eye of the entrepreneur. And so I'm willing to bet on the future, the next generation, the new entrant. And oh, by the way, if you're a political leader, think about what that means for your economy. Are you propping up old industries, or are you encouraging institutionally the formation of new industries as quickly as possible? Any place on planet Earth that generates new companies more quickly and more easily than another will win in the long haul. This is why I think authoritarian regimes will stagnate. They will prop up the big companies that have influence and power, as do some captured democracies, when politics takes over, and that'll just hold them back. Inevitably, if you held back Tesla, think about how much longer it would take in the transition to sustainable energy and transportation. And so for the good of the world, and for the good of course, individuals within this world, we want to encourage the new entrant, and that's what I'm willing to bet on. So please email me, email yourself, and circle me back in 2042. I hope I have enough money, if some of you guess right. And the reason, by the way, I said a company and not a person, because I think it generally holds true for people, is it's possible that a person will have multiple startups. So I don't want to bet against Elon Musk's next startup. So that's why I didn't want to include people, because a lot of people just throw down Elon Musk, thinking SpaceX, thinking Tesla. But 20 years from now, I bet you the most important company will be whatever he starts next.
I think you're totally right. And by the way, 25 years ago, there were no Amazon, no Google.
Looking back, it's like, oh yeah,
of course. Looking back, it's crazy.
You have a hard time looking forward and saying the same thing. Yeah.
I mean, thank you so much. I mean, this is really inspiring. For me, I mean, you were mentioning the founder, you know, who are so much driven by their mission or their purpose. I totally see that you are also driven by your mission, which is exactly what you just described, like funding the deep tech to change the world. And I find it, you know, exactly what the audience needs. And thank you so much for being with us and answering the question.
Absolutely. Happy to be here. Thank you.
Thank you.